Hello and welcome to another weekly episode of Bitching About Movies. This is the WTWTW, aka What to Watch This Week for April 9th through April 15th of 2018. You know, Matt, some people read War and Peace and come away thinking it's a simple adventure story. Others can read the ingredients on a chewing gum wrapper and unlock the secrets of the universe.
It's all about perspective.
Yeah, exactly. That's maybe what I was trying to say there. We do this every week. We try to be the best at giving you an idea of what to watch.
Yeah, there's so much shit out there between streaming services.
Emphasis on shit.
Yeah, renting on VOD. I mean, if you have three different streaming services, which, you know, if you're watching the amount of movies that we are, you've got at least three. There's a lot of shit to sift through. So that's why we like to do this every Monday. We take a look at what's coming out over the course of the next week, whether it's in theaters, at home, on Blu-ray. We'll even talk about just random shit we've watched and tell you whether or not it's worth your time.
Yeah, some interesting reviews at the end of the podcast.
Yep.
I watched some ultra-violent films, Mom and Dad and Mayhem, and then you're updating with your most recent installment in the MCU rewatch.
Yep, which, I'm trying to watch all the Marvel movies for Infinity War. Also, if you haven't listened to it yet, go back. Our last WTWTW episode had a Ready Player One review from Frank, and then our episode just prior to this that came out this past Friday is our big Wes Anderson Part One breakdown, and we have a fresh Isle of Dogs review in there as well. So if you're kind of on the fence about Isle of Dogs, or if you just really like Wes Anderson and want to hear us talk about him, I think you'll be surprised by some of our opinions on those movies.
I was surprised.
Yeah, you were. You were surprised, but
insulted.
go back and listen to that, especially for that Isle of Dogs review. And that's all the housekeeping I got. You want to jump into some trailer talk?
Yeah, I'm not a fan of housekeeping, so let's begin this episode how we do each and every week with some trailers. Up first is Cargo. This is going to be, I believe, a limited release in theaters May 18th.
I'm unsure, actually, what's going on with this movie. It's coming out, like, wide release in Australia on May 18th. This is an Australian movie that's being shopped around. Like, it's already been at some Australian and UK film festivals. And in April, on April 19th, it'll be premiering at the Tribeca Film Festival. So what I'm thinking is going to happen is it'll premiere there and then get opted and, like, be purchased and then get a U.S. release date. So
yeah, I mean, May 18th is a Friday. It's a, you know, theatrical release day. It looks like VOD / limited release quality.
Yes.
It's a post-apocalyptic wasteland. Oh, I don't see those enough. A father, played by Martin Freeman, has 48 hours to get his child to safety before he transforms into a creature, which looks like kind of like a zombie. So it's like a precious cargo mission. But
yeah, he's trying to get his baby to safety. This is a really interesting concept. Like, I'm really into the idea of Martin Freeman playing this dad who's on a ticking clock, you know, race against time to rescue his child, a child who can't fend for itself, no less. So, like, the stakes are really, really high. This is one of those trailers, though, and I just stumbled across this randomly this morning, but it gives away entirely too much. This trailer shows you a lot of the movie.
Yeah, it does.
Especially the beginning. I feel like the entire first act is shown you in this trailer. So I am telling you, if you're a fan of zombie stuff, if you like Australian cinema, if you like Martin Freeman, this is a movie to have on your radar, but maybe avoid the trailer. I just feel like it gives you a little bit too much, shows you too much of that story. This is going to probably sneak up on people, and it feels like it could be... it could be something. There could be something here. So I'm really intrigued by this. And any excuse for a, you know, anything out of the ordinary for a zombie type movie, I'm into.
Yeah. Up next, also due out May 18th in theaters, is the latest from A24. First Reform, about a former military chaplain, is wrecked with grief over the death of his son. And then Mary is a member of his church whose husband, a radical environmentalist, commits suicide, setting the plot in motion. This stars Ethan Hawke, the classic, like, questioning faith of a pastor, struggling with, you know, the real world consequences and his prior beliefs. I thought this one looks really cool. It digs deep. It looks like it's about a tortured man. I think Ethan Hawke can pull this off. I think he's, you know, He's
I do like Ethan Hawke.
Underrated guy. Yeah.
I don't know, man. As much as I trust A24, this is one of the few trailers that they've put out for a movie that just doesn't do anything for me. It looks like it could be real, like a fucking snore fest. But I'm also not really into movies about religion. I don't know if this is a movie about religion or if it's just this character that's in this, you know, part of this world. It's got an interesting cast. Like you said, Ethan Hawke, Amanda Seyfried. I think Cedric the Entertainer is in there too, like doing a more serious kind of role. Yeah. Which he can do it, whatever. But
Cedric the Dramatic Entertainer.
I don't know, man. It looks like it would be mostly boring.
It is sprinkled with a lot of praise throughout the trailer, which can sometimes be dubious.
Yeah. Yeah, like they're trying too hard. I mean, it's A24, so part of me wants to trust that whatever it is, it'll be good, but I'd have to see some reviews before I dive into this.
It looks good, interesting, not great from the trailer. I don't think it's going to win any awards, but I like stuff like this. I like, you know, this is about a real type of person and just dealing with big life issues. It's directed and written by Paul Schrader, who like wrote Raging Bull and Taxi Driver. So in Affliction, I don't remember that one, Nick Nolte. So he kind of like likes to be like do these type of tortured characters, obviously. Yeah. So he shows that dark side of life. So it's in good hands. He also has some, you know, a couple dozen directing credits. Most recently, what would you say? The Canyons, which I didn't think was that good.
I don't think I saw that one.
But he's done Affliction, some other things. So American Gigolo, Cat People. So his director and writer credits span like 4 different decades. So
okay, so there's a guy with some talent behind here.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, like I said, if reviews come out and say it's really good, it could be the kind of thing I check out. But as it stands, trailer didn't really do anything to win me over.
Gotcha.
Little more of a like traditional kind of, you know, this is definitely going to be a wide release. Coming out August 3rd is The Darkest Minds, which is like a dystopian future sci-fi starring teens with incredible powers. They're imprisoned by an adult world that now fears anyone under the age of 18. And it's about a group of teens that forms a resistance group to fight back and reclaim the future. This seems pretty cookie cutter. I'm even less interested in this than the first Reformed. At least, like, that looked like it had interesting, unique characters in it.
Yeah.
This The Darkest Minds could be any fucking group of teens.
Yeah, pretty generic X-Men wannabe shit here.
That's what it is, X-Men wannabe.
Jennifer Yu Nelson, who was, like, all over the Kung Fu Panda series. And, you know, as an art director, part of the art department from other films. Yeah, this one didn't really do much for me. I didn't know Mandy Moore was in it until I read that. She wasn't really first and up front in the trailer, which is interesting because she's as popular as ever after she's in that TV show that everyone cries about. I'm probably going to skip this one unless I hear great things. You know, I'm not, like, a sucker for superhero stuff. But I'd say something similar to this that it reminded me of, which I think is great, is Children of Men. Do you ever see that movie?
Yes. Yeah, Children of Men is great.
Because, they also kind of, like, mentioned in the beginning of this trailer that children aren't being born anymore. So they're, like, more of a resource, and they're feared because they have powers. Mm-hmm. Apparently all of them have powers in this movie. Out of these three, I would say First Reform is probably my pick, the one I'm most likely to see. But, you know, nothing that, you know, knocks my socks off or anything like that.
Yeah, see, I feel like Cargo is definitely my pick. It's just, it's a really interesting concept, and it could be based on how small the cast is. I mean, Martin Freeman probably carries a lot of it. I think he can do it. It seems like the kind of thing that's in his wheelhouse, and hopefully someone at Tribeca likes it enough to purchase it and bring it stateside and get it to us sooner rather than later.
Cool. And those are coming out sooner than later. But say I want to see something now, this weekend. Say it's before April 13th of 2018, or it is April 13th, 2018. What can I watch?
Well, let me ask you this. Do you like movies where Dwayne Johnson makes jokes about how big his arms are?
Come on, you know me.
Do you like movies where Dwayne Johnson flies a helicopter through predicaments where no one should be flying a helicopter?
Yeah, that's another check mark. Is he wearing a brown collared shirt?
Maybe.
With sleeves rolled up.
Maybe.
As in Jumanji and other films.
But only until he gets torn up enough that he then is only wearing the white you know, undershirt underneath that.
Does he have a friend named George who's like a gray gorilla?
Yes, he does.
Yes.
So there is a movie out this week for you.
Yeah.
And it's called Rampage.
A very self-aware movie, and also the fact that they push it up a week because they didn't want to compete with Super Troopers. Did you notice that?
Well, they also didn't want it to be too close to Infinity War. They wanted to give it some time to breathe. And there's this is really the biggest thing coming out this weekend, so it makes sense for them to have moved it.
I'm going to see this movie.
You think so?
For sure.
I can see myself seeing this, unless reviews are so atrocious that people say to actively avoid it.
I watch Baywatch, dude. So,
what are your thoughts on San Andreas? Because this is directed by the same guy that did San Andreas.
I didn't see that one.
Really?
I should, yeah.
That one I did see. Yeah, Brad Peyton directed that one. You would probably like San Andreas. It's if you like disaster movies, mm-hmm. you know, maybe there's a disaster movie genre episode coming up in our future.
It's definitely going to be a rock movie episode.
But, I mean, yeah, I could be convinced to see this if the reviews are, you know, even mediocre.
Yeah, definitely more interested than the next two, and I think you're going to be in agreement with me.
Yeah.
Truth or Dare, like, this movie has been hyped for months now. It's the latest, you say stupidly, simple horror movie about a pretty young white people doing dumb shit and dying in insane ways. Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
That's pretty much the only way I can describe
they're
it.
They're more missed than hit, but I consider them good because people want horror movies, and they seem to churn them out with ease and, you know, in a way that they are profitable consistently. So some good stuff's going to come out of this. I don't think it even looks as good as Happy Death Day, which wasn't a masterpiece itself. But people are going to watch this.
They're just using, like, the dumbest concepts to get horror movies made these days. Between this and, like, you know, how many Ouija board movies do we need? And just...
Yeah.
And even Happy Death Day is like such a cookie cutter concept. Oh, it's Groundhog Day, but she dies at the end of the day. Like,
that was clever enough for me. That was entertaining.
I don't know. I feel like Truth or Dare is like drawing a fucking line.
Hey, at least they're not insulting 1980s Kurt Russell Goldie Hawn movies by remaking them for no reason.
Yeah, who wanted an Overboard remake? Why is that coming out this week? That movie already, like, the original's not good. Why remake it? Just to gender swap and make it even? Like, I don't get it, man. And Anna Faris, like, I like her in a lot of stuff, but I feel like lately she's just chosen the easy paycheck roles, man. And this looks like one if I've ever seen one.
Yeah, and I'm actually, this one might get pushed back too. There's actually, like, no, they haven't done any public screenings of this yet.
Really?
So you might not even be able to see it this weekend.
I feel like this movie's going to tank. this is absolutely going to make, like, no money. It'll be one of the worst reviewed movies of the year. I don't see this movie doing good at all.
Yeah, so I mean, whether or not it comes out this weekend, I can't recommend seeing it. It sucks. Like, shit like this frustrates me because Anna Faris is entertaining. I love her. And I'd like to see her in something that I want to watch. I want to watch her. But she's got a great podcast.
Yeah.
So enjoy her there or rewatch her older, better movies.
Have you seen Smiley Face?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's Smiley Face.
That's a good one with her. Yeah. I think our theatrical pick of the week, though, definitely Rampage. Easy pick. Easy pick.
Just think of how far you've come via, you know, rock movies from the beginning of this podcast.
Oh, I like The Rock. I've always liked The Rock. I just feel like there's a lot to mock about The Rock.
Yeah. Say you weren't convinced by us and you're not going out to the theaters. You're just not dealing with the public. You don't have movie pass yet.
Say you're a bubble boy.
Yeah.
Who can't go outside in the atmosphere. You'll die.
Or you just, you know, in these financial times, you can't afford a movie ticket.
Nope, but you can afford to have your parents' Netflix log in. Yeah. So that's what you do. Lost in Space, the new, like, reboot of Lost in Space that Netflix is doing. That premieres Friday, April 13th. You know what, though? I just watched the trailer for this today. I was kind of avoiding it because I've never really given a fuck about Lost in Space. But this looks pretty cool, I have to say. I'm intrigued by this. This is definitely the kind of thing that I would watch. More so than, like, if I sat through two fucking episodes of Altered Carbon, I can watch at least one episode of Lost in Space. Like, I'll give it a shot.
Yeah, breaking news. I actually pushed this up 2 days for whatever reason.
Oh, really?
13th now. Netflix just does whatever they want. They might have released it in the middle of talking about this. That's an interesting thing because I don't think anyone else has seen it, so I don't know why they're moving it up. But hey, you know, this one has gotten some hype. I'm probably not going to watch it unless I hear it's fantastic. I just have no time for mediocre TV shows, and that's what I think this looks like.
This is going to be the kind of show that I'll be caught up on all my other TV shows, and me and the girlfriend will go to sit down and eat dinner and be like, oh, what are we going to watch? Oh, let's watch the first episode of Lost in Space.
20-minute void.
Yeah, this is going to be one of those. I'm sure I'll have a review of at least the first episode with you guys before too long.
Cool.
But that's really it for Netflix. It's a small week for them. It's the middle of the month, so you're not going to get a lot of stuff.
Huh? No, yeah, even smaller for Prime.
Nothing.
Yeah, go back and listen to our previous episodes. I mean, they killed it last week.
Yeah, last week you had Legacy of a Whitetail Deer.
Killing of a Sacred
Killing
Deer.
Killing of a Sacred Deer. I'm going to get those two titles mixed up consistently. Killing of a Sacred Deer and the Florida Project. So maybe if you watched one last week, watch one of the other ones this week.
Yeah, for sure. Hulu is a mid-month movie dump. The rarely seen.
Yeah.
And you were interested in American Gangster.
I've never seen it. Yeah. Is it good?
It's pretty good. It's, Russell Crowe and Denzel Washington, right? In their prime. It's not quite Godfather or Goodfellas, but it's good. There's some really great acting. I think these guys make great rivals. The cat and mouse game between them is really good. So, yeah, if you haven't seen it yet, it's definitely worth watching.
My only experience with this movie is in college, a friend of mine, we were at a party and a friend of mine spilled some wine on a carpet, mm-hmm. and someone made a big deal about how you're supposed to splotch it, not rub it, because he learned that from American Gangster.
Look at that.
That's the only thing I learned that from a movie I've never seen before, and it's just stuck with me.
That's funny. So yeah, that's out there. Also, you like to mention Life is Beautiful is also available.
Yeah, this was on Amazon Prime earlier in the month. If you don't have that and you do have Hulu, Life is Beautiful. I mean, come on, man. You're never going to see a better, more heartwarming movie about the Holocaust and actually feel good about yourself.
A movie that could affect you, really, affect your life and impact you, make you feel feelings.
Yep.
That's okay.
Go watch that. HBO.
Ooh.
Some interesting stuff coming to HBO.
I'm most hyped for maybe all month for this Andre the Giant documentary. I grew up on wrestling. Andre the Giant is one of the most fascinating humans to ever live. Also, I'm a big Princess Bride fan, and I thought he had a great performance there. This is a look at the life and career of professional wrestler Andre Rusevnov, who gained notoriety in the 80s as Andre the Giant. It's produced by Bill Simmons, who I've been a big fan of. Mm-hmm. He was the creator of the ESPN 30 for 30 series, and he's now with HBO, and I think he said so far, I mean, it had a big premiere in LA, so this one's really been pumped up.
Yeah,
and it's one of
this is a big deal for HBO.
Yeah, he's most proud of this one, and I'm really looking forward to this. It looks like it's very well done, and could introduce people to a character they never knew.
Yeah, I'm only vaguely interested in professional wrestling, but if I had to pick an era to care about, it would be 80s wrestling. Mm-hmm. I can see myself watching this, honestly, not knowing much about the actual guy, Andre the Giant. Mm-hmm. I can see myself watching this. So.
I'm going to watch it, so you will get a review next episode. Cool.
Also, I thought worth mentioning, just because it feels like every comedian with a political skew these days is getting their own show. HBO is giving one to The Daily Show's Wyatt Cenac. Mm-hmm. Wyatt Cenac's Problem Areas, that premieres Friday, April 13th. Rather than sitting behind a desk, he's doing more of a stand-up centered political talk show. He'll have on scene location type stuff. Mm-hmm.
It's interesting.
Could be interesting. I haven't really seen anything from it. I don't know if I really need to. I really like John Oliver Last Week Tonight.
Yeah.
That's like
best show on TV.
That's my go-to for political satire. So if this Wyatt Cenac show is half as good as that, I can see adding it to my weekly rotation.
Yeah, for sure. It looks interesting. I'll give it a shot. At least a show like this, maybe check in the beginning and then check out the end of season one. Because something like this definitely takes time to form. If you even go back and look at early Daily Shows or Conan, there's some
growing
pains in this. Yeah, for sure. Okay.
So streaming was pretty light this week. Not a lot for our streaming services.
Agreed.
But there's a lot of good stuff coming on VOD and disc. And even if it's not great stuff, some of this is stuff that I definitely need to cross off my list. So Tuesday, April 10th, coming to VOD and Blu-ray all on the same day. All the Money in the World, mm-hmm. the Ridley Scott movie that famously replaced Kevin Spacey with Christopher Plummer. I don't know if I'm going to watch this. I got to be in the right mood for crime thriller type things. And there's so much behind the scenes turmoil in this movie. I don't know if it's even worth it.
It does have my girl Michelle Williams in it though, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So that could be a reason enough. She's so good. How is she not I don't know. One more. I think she's won at least one Oscar, right?
Oh.
criminally underrated. Like, I'll support it just for her because she's fantastic.
Also coming out is The Greatest Showman. This is that Hugh Jackman, P.T. Barnum movie. I'm not going to watch
Barnum's
this.
P.T. Barnum's a horrible person. Why did you give him a fucking musical?
People love this fucking movie, though. Like, at least Broadway fans seem to love this movie.
Broadway by way of Hamilton. It's the people that like Hamilton and Frozen that wouldn't shut up and stop singing those songs. Like, they love this Greatest Showman thing. Suckers for musicals. And no, I need cannibals, or I need like fucking killing puppets, because, you know, that's just the way I enjoy musicals. Yeah, this one is just so pandering. I'm never gonna watch this movie.
Yeah, same.
Fuck that. And I love Hugh Jackman, but yeah, no, sorry. P.T. Barnum, fuck circuses, fuck P.T. Barnum.
Yeah, I'm not into that movie at all. Also, not really into it. Now, you saw this one, Molly's Game.
I liked it. Good, not great.
Kind of boring.
It's Aaron Sorkin, man, so it's a lot of dialogue. I can't think of the actress's name. I'm like drawing a blank. Jessica Chastain's amazing.
And Idris Elba's in it too.
Yeah,
right?
Idris Elba's okay. He's not a challenging performance, but Jessica Chastain is kick ass in this movie. She's fucking awesome. Like, she's a great actress, and like, I want to see her. I hope this movie made enough money where she can star in more stuff and lead more movies, because she carries this movie.
Cool.
She's everything about it.
Are you excited that this is finally coming out? Because I am. I'm finally going
to
be able to
see if it lives up to the hype. Phantom Thread.
Yeah, I'm going to cross it off my need to catch up on list.
My favorite movie so far of 2018, because we run the regular calendar. We don't go by award season.
Yeah.
On this show.
Yeah.
Daniel Day-Lewis's swan song. He's retiring on this one, allegedly.
And Paul Thomas Anderson is one of those directors that I just need to see everything he puts out. Yeah. So I'll get to it sooner rather than later.
Yeah. I mean, you could dismiss this as, okay, it's a guy who makes dresses and, it's slow paced or whatever. But I think the acting in this movie is like without a peer in the past 2 years in a while. Like, it's awesome. And Daniel Day-Lewis has a way of just bringing up everyone around him. So just like some of the best performances I've seen in the past couple years. And a movie that just is about all of the shit we like to cover up with, pretty clothing and dresses and cakes and stuff like that. And a lot of food in this movie as well. There Will Be Food is like the alternate title that film Twitter likes to talk about it.
I may wait on this for a little bit. I get the feeling that it'll be on HBO or Amazon Prime sometime in the next couple months.
I'll probably May. It's a great looking movie as well. So I highly recommend it. So check out Phantom Thread eventually, however you feel comfortable watching it.
And last but not least, worth mentioning Taraji P. Henson's Proud Mary.
Mm-hmm.
Her like take on John Wick or Atomic Blonde. I haven't heard anything one way or another about this movie, but if it pops up on a streaming service in the future, I can see myself watching it.
Mm-hmm. Hey, it's out there.
Yeah, it's a thing that you can watch. That's it, man. It's a small week for the at-home releases. It's really a small week in general.
I think it's a spring break week. That's probably why it's light on that. A lot of people are on spring break in college, so they probably don't want to compete with day drinking. So, because, what movie can?
So if that's the case, if we don't have anything that we can strongly recommend, I mean, other than Phantom Thread, obviously,
we should end the show.
I think we should talk about just random shit we've watched lately. Okay. How about I just knocked the Civil War review out of the park. So watching all the Marvel Cinematic Universe movies, I finally made it up to Captain America Civil War, which is something that Frank and I strongly disagree on.
Yeah, probably one of our best movie fights ever.
Here's the thing. Having rewatched it, it dipped a little bit for me. I don't dislike it on the level that you do, but it did. Like, I see the criticisms. I see the criticisms of this movie now.
You gotta be separated from the hype, you know?
Not even that. I think it works as a larger part of the Marvel puzzle. But it, as a movie by itself, is much more concerned with introducing new things than just allowing itself to be a Captain America movie. That being said, the balancing act that was forced upon this movie is handled pretty well. Way more so than something like Avengers Age of Ultron, which I shit all over last week. Not a fan of that movie. Yeah, Age of Ultron's still the lowest possible point in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. But Civil War is okay. I just think, as much as I love Tom Holland's introduction as Spider-Man, it wasn't needed. As much as I love Chadwick Boseman's introduction as Black Panther, it wasn't needed. Like, there was a lot of this movie that was really just forced setup, and I think the script and the Russo brothers did the best they could to make everything coherent. But there's a lot of this movie that's just wasted. One of the things that stood out to me that I liked the most, though, I'm more of a fan of Tony Stark's progression through the movie than I was before. Because I'm pretty staunch Team Cap when it comes to his decision to not sign the Sokovia Accords.
Yeah.
But Tony Stark does in this movie what it makes sense for him to do. He does the same thing he does in every movie.
I'll agree with you there. That puzzle makes sense.
He self-destructs and he does the exact thing he's not supposed to do because he's been struggling with PTSD. He's worried about accountability. I mean, he created Ultron, and Ultron is responsible for killing countless people. Mm-hmm. And he's confronted with that pretty early in the movie by a mom whose son was like backpacking across Europe and died in the Sokovia incident. So he feels that guilt, and he wants to do the right thing for a change, and he thinks that he is, and he kind of isn't. He also is being betrayed by this person that he thought was his friend, Steve Rogers, who could not disagree more about accountability. And there's things to be said on both sides.
I think the performances are good. I think Chris Evans and Robert Downey Jr. carry like the bad movies for sure, like Ultron and this. Like, my critique, and usually where we butt heads on these, is like, I don't care as much about the puzzle pieces and the table setting and, you know, the biography part of it as like the movies themselves. And when these end up being more of just, you know, setting up an upcoming movie, I think it definitely wears on the rewatchability of it as well.
Unless you're doing the rewatch like I'm doing it, where it's all one coherent story.
For sure.
But as a solo rewatch, I can't see this movie holding up as well as I would have hoped. Definitely not as well as Winter Soldier. Like, Winter Soldier stands alone as like a good sequel and a good standalone Captain America movie. Civil War is a little more concerned with the Marvel Universe at large. But yeah, there's stuff in there to pick apart. There's stuff in there to really like. The airport scene, which I would have said before this, was like one of the best scenes in a Marvel movie. Like, it's competently shot and it's a cool superhero fight scene, but really, from a script perspective, that airport scene is not good. It's very, very forced.
Yeah, it's a lot of it's forced. And I also didn't like how safe this movie was. Like, I thought they would start killing off some people with this one, and like, there's some damage done, but it just felt too safe and not as thrilling otherwise when you know no one's going to die. So I watched some ultra-violent stuff this weekend. Two very similar movies because they deal with just like huge outbreaks. The first being Mom and Dad, and the reason I watched this movie, one, is because Nicolas Cage is in it, and, you know, crazy Nicolas Cage, who doesn't like that? Selma Blair also is someone who I liked in the past and haven't seen a lot of. But it was a 99-cent rental, and hopefully while you're listening to this, it still is on Amazon Prime, iTunes, and some other devices. And it's something we probably should try to do a better job of featuring, like, the budget rental sales.
Right, right.
And I know the way iTunes work, and I suspect probably similar to Amazon, you can click on the 99-cent rental and you have like 30 days to watch it. So you can build up a queue if you you want to watch these things when you want to watch them and not spend a lot of money on them. And this film is directed and written by Brian Taylor, who may not be a familiar name, but definitely puts out a certain type of movie.
He did Crank and Crank 2, right?
Crank 2, Gamer. He wrote Jonah Hex. He also directed The Ghost Rider, Spirit of Vengeance, which was the one with Nicolas Cage.
Well, they were both with Nicolas Cage.
I guess you're right. So he directed like the second one, which is definitely had a different style, Crank type style to it.
Yeah, yeah,
which it was is a little more wild. Hectic, my favorite of the two, if you're going to like judge those two bad movies. But the point is, like, this is someone who's definitely done this before, and this movie is like the reverse of the movie Cooties that came out like a couple years ago, where there's a rage incident. The origins of it are kind of unknown here. And it's a 24-hour incident where parents are just kind of turned into killing machines, but the killing is only directed at their offspring, at their children. So each parent is just trying to kill their child. They're really not concerned with anyone else. And it centers around this nuclear family where Nicolas Cage is the father. Selma Blair plays the mother. They're a typical unhappy portrayal of a family. They have an older teenage daughter played by Ann Winters and a younger teenage boy. Or not actually, I'd say probably like grade school to middle school aged young boy played by Josh Ryan. And like the charm wore off on this one quick for me, man. Like, I can't really recommend this movie.
Really?
Despite the fact you can get it for a dollar. Yeah, I mean, the Nicolas Cage thing, like, there's not much depth to his crazy character. And even the blow-ups weren't super entertaining. He does some physical stuff in this movie. Just didn't care, man. I thought it was kind of like a weak script. Like, the motivation isn't really there. I didn't care much for the characters. The gore was all right. The performances were all right. But in the end, I didn't enjoy it as much as I wanted to. Not that it was boring, but there was kind of pointless movie. Hmm. Yeah, in the end, kind of just pointless. And there's the setup really is that these people are unhappy and they try to kill their kids. Okay. And the way it ends, nothing's really resolved. Like, you don't really learn anything. So, yeah, can't say I want our audience to spend 90 minutes on that one.
Well, I can honestly say I was interested in this movie before, but typically I trust you, man. If you tell me that strongly not to do something, you know, it's not like when you watch Little Hours and we just disagreed on that because you were like, oh, I liked it, but it wasn't great.
Yeah.
This one, if you're saying to actively avoid it, like, you don't do that lately. So I think I might actively avoid it.
Yeah, because we're getting better at picking at what we want to watch. And, yeah. You know. So let me spare y'all 90 minutes of your lives and do a service by wasting 90 minutes of mine on that one. So, yeah. Can't see you all. I'll recommend a similar movie next after you talk about yours.
So I took a break from the Marvel movies. My girlfriend had a really shitty day at work, and, you know, I wanted to watch a movie, and she was into that. So I was like, let's sit down. We'll pick a movie. We'll eat dinner.
What a sweet man.
I'm just going to go to a streaming service, and I'm going to pick the first random thing I can find that I think she would like that I also maybe haven't seen. And I stumbled across on Amazon Prime Daybreakers with Ethan Hawke, Sam Neill, Willem Dafoe. This is a movie about like a future dystopia where vampires rule over everything. Like, the majority of the population are vampires and they're running low on blood. There's like a blood shortage that's turning some of the vampires feral and making them transform into these like grotesque monstrosities. And Ethan Hawke plays a vampire scientist who works for this like human farming company who's obsessed with creating like a synthetic blood because he's not into eating humans. He's got a conscience. I knew my girlfriend liked vampire movies and was okay with gore stuff. And I had seen like a 15-minute chunk of this movie one time, like definitely first third of the movie setup stuff. But I had seen enough to know that, okay, I could sit down and watch this movie. And it's relatively short, too. It's only like an hour and a half. Mm-hmm. Not bad, actually. It definitely is more of like a cool concept over execution. It definitely falls apart towards the like end of the second act. The plot just starts falling the fuck apart and stops making sense. But it's a really strong opening to this movie. I really like how they show you how the world has changed to adapt to vampires. Like little things like showing us how their cars have cameras on them to stop them from letting UV light in.
Oh, yeah, I remember
like,
that.
Like, this movie's just, it's really good at showing you and not telling you the rules of the vampire universe, as opposed to, like, fucking Blade, which is an easy comparison for me to make, because I just watched Blade and Blade 2 for the first time a few months ago, which, if you guys haven't, you can go back and listen to our Black Action Heroes topic episode. I have full reviews of the first two Blades, even though you don't really need them. You don't need to watch them. But those are the easy comparison because those are the other vampire movies I've watched lately. And those movies, like the first Blade especially, Chris Christopherson's character has like a whole fucking monologue about the rules of how to kill a vampire and what's going on. And Daybreakers was more like show, don't tell. And I respect that as a sci-fi decision.
Me too. Yeah.
So yeah, a lot of interesting things going on. Willem Dafoe plays this mysterious human character who used to be a vampire and has cured. So Ethan Hawke's trying to recreate that cure. Again, when this movie tries to adhere logic to anything, it really starts to fall apart. But it's got some strong performances in it. It's got some really good creature design and some really interesting like practical effects. So there's, if you like vampire stuff, this I could actually recommend it. I wouldn't recommend it to people that aren't typically into into horror, gore, monster movies, but if you do like vampire stuff, it's better than a lot of the shit out there. It really is. and it definitely gets props for building its universe subtly and not shoving it in your fucking face. So that's on Amazon Prime. If you have it and you can watch it for free, it isn't a bad watch. If I never see it again, fine. But it, out of all the vampire movies I've watched in 2018, it is the best.
Yeah, I remember kind of liking that one too and thinking it was better than I thought it was going to be because, you know, most vampire movies suck.
I can see how it would slide under people's radar, honestly. Yeah,
yeah. As I was balling on a budget this weekend, I watched another 99-cent rental available on iTunes and Amazon Prime Video. In a little known fact, you can actually rent stuff off your Amazon Prime app as well. Not all of this is free. Mayhem. So this is the workplace action horror, extremely violent movie starring Steven Yeun from Walking Dead fame. And also Samara Weaving, who you may have seen in Babysitters.
Okay.
She was also in, she played like the dumb girlfriend, I believe, or maybe the daughter in Three Billboards outside Ebbing, Missouri. And she was in an episode of Ash vs. Evil Dead. I watched all those things, so I recognize her pretty well. She's been popping up in stuff I've watched recently. And this one is very similar to the Belko experiment, where it all takes place in an office space that has been quarantined. Mm-hmm. And
I really liked Belko experiment.
Yeah. I mean, I think this one's just as good. It's about a virus that's spread throughout a legal firm. And Steven Yeun's character, not telling anything, it's not in a trailer. He gets set up. He gets fired. And he's trapped. He's trying to leave the workplace as this virus spreads. And he was part of the legal team that let someone get off for murder due to this virus. So it's like a known virus that they're trying to take care of. And the can see in this movie is that you're allowed to murder people because there's already precedence that like it's okay. Like you'll just be considered temporarily insane. And there's also like people just turn animalistic. So there's like fucking going on in the background. It's more violent than that, though. Okay. There's like nudity and stuff, if that is a selling point or deterrent, I'd put that out there. And it's very, very violent, and I thought pretty clever. I definitely had a lot more fun with this one than Mom and Dad. I thought that, you know, there's a storyline that this guy got fucked over by his job, and you know, he's been devoting, you know, more to his job than any other aspect of his life, and he's getting dicked over, and he realized how much time he wasted. And he's teamed up with this lady who comes at the firm because, you know, her house is getting foreclosed and they won't even give her a break on it. They're just going to swallow up their mm-hmm. her assets and stuff like that. So these are characters you can relate to, because who hasn't like been late on a bill or hated their job? So, you know, I thought they were at least relatable, likable characters. And there's some chemistry there. And, you know, there's villains, you know, unlike Mom and Dad. There's things, people you didn't like. You know, who doesn't hate a, like, faceless corporation at this point or a greedy CEO? And you have all that there. And the gore's really well shot. It's, like, breakneck pace. You know, there's a little bit of setup and then it's just all these two characters weaving through the different levels as they try to work their way up to the showdown with the CEO. And I had a lot of fun with it. I think this one is worth your time.
Okay, cool.
It's another 90-minute movie.
I was excited for this one, too. Yeah. So.
It's interesting, too, that at least in some foreign countries, the title for this one has been changed in a way that it suggests it's a sequel to Belko Experiment.
Really?
Even though these movies aren't related in any way. Yeah, I thought that was funny, like, the way that these things can get advertised in other countries.
Yeah, that's weird.
Yeah, that translates as, like, you know, Belko Experiment, too. But, yeah, man, I'd recommend this one. It's, you know, if you're just in the mood for some good B-movie violence, man, like, it's not going to win any awards, but it entertained me.
Right on. Yeah, like we said, you know, we try to cover more movies in any one episode than most movie podcasts are going to mm-hmm. do. So I know that this was a light week for streaming stuff, but you've got to find something in there worth watching. There's something that we've talked about that you're going to like. So.
Under the Giant Dock, Rampage, and Mayhem would be my recommendations. Like, those are three things that, you know, you should like at least one of those.
yeah, and that's really like covering the board too. Uh-huh. But you know, let us know if you watch something that we recommended, or if you watch something that we told you to stay away from and you liked it. Tweet us, find us on Facebook, find us on Instagram. Let mm-hmm. us know that we were right or wrong.
You can leave slide us a into review. The DMs.
Yeah, I'll you answer can do them. That. Yeah, Frank does all that. You can send us whatever you want. Send dick pics. I don't care. Frank will see them.
No, don't do that. I don't need it.
Yeah, don't send dick pics. Yeah, but leave us a review on iTunes if you haven't already. That's greatly appreciated. Subscribing as well. If this is like your first or second episode, you're going to want more. So just hit that subscribe button and let your phone download it for you.
And like Matt said, we do topical episodes. So we're going to do this every week. We're shooting this one a little early just because, you know, we will work around our lives to make sure each week we'll give you some recommendations and tell you what to avoid. But we also have topical episodes.
Yeah.
We got, like, what, the 420 one coming up?
Yeah, we're going to do a 420 special on stoner movies. We're going to do a Broken Lizard episode in celebration of Super Troopers 2. Like we said earlier, our most recent episode was Wes Anderson Part 1. There's going to be a Part 2. We've also done heist movies, black action heroes. What else have we done lately?
Video game movies.
Jesus Christ. If you want to hear us actually bitch about some movies, the video game movies Part 2 that we did. Holy fuck. And we have a review. We try to loop these things into, like, current movies, too. So, like, in the video game episode, we reviewed the new Tomb Raider. In the Wes Anderson episode, we reviewed the new Isle of Dogs. So, there's stuff there for you, for both new and old fans.
And we span all genres and decades.
Oh, yeah. We don't discriminate. Mm-hmm. So, can you think of anything else you want to say to the people, Frank?
No, I'll leave it up to you to close the podcast how you always seem to close the podcast.
Cool. Go to bed, motherfuckers.
Bye.
Whenever life gets you down, Mrs. Brown, and things seem hard or tough, and people are stupid, obnoxious, or daft, and you feel that you've had quite enough, just remember that you're standing on a planet that's evolving and revolving at 900 miles an hour. That's orbiting at 90 miles a second, so it's reckoned a sun that is the source of all our power. The sun and you and me and all the stars that we can see are moving at a million miles a day. In an outer spiral arm at 40,000 miles an hour, the galaxy we call the Milky Way. Our galaxy itself contains 100 billion stars. It's 100,000 light years side to side. It bulges in the middle, 16,000 light years thick, but out by us it's just 3,000 light years wide. We're 30,000 light years from galactic central point. We go round every 200 million years. And our galaxy is only one of millions of billions in this amazing and expanding universe. Keeps on expanding and expanding in all of the directions it can whiz. As fast as it can go, at the speed of light you know, 12 million miles a minute, and that's the fastest speed there is. So remember when you're feeling very small and insecure, how amazingly unlikely is your birth. And pray that there's intelligent life somewhere up in space, 'cause there's bugger all down here on Earth.